paying my respects to the traditional elders of our the countries on which we're meeting. I'm up here in on the Tablelands, and it's the Tableland Yidinji. So I'd like to pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. And you quietly do the same in your respective patches of the country across Queensland. Welcome everybody to our first ever broader SWIFT one-on-one webinar. My name is Penny Scott, and my co-deliverer is Lee Blacklock there, who you'll be from very soon. We know that we are recording this session, and if anyone has any issues with that, please let us know. Not. Okay. Welcome, everybody. We are not going to do introductions of everybody today because there are is a cast of thousands. But I would like to, I'm CEO of NRM Regions Queensland, to give a brief introduction to this session before we get stuck into it. Chris.
Thanks, Penny. Not sure how well I'm coming across because you're very pixelated at my end and I've had lots of problems this morning. So apologies if I'm not coming across well, because you can never tell at this end, can you? So firstly, thanks a lot to everybody for making the time. Pretty short notice for pulling this together, but as you're all aware, under the Natural Resources Recovery Program, those projects are only starting to initiate now. And given the requirements for everyone to use the statewide indicators framework, we felt it was very necessary to start today as a bit of an introductory. So Penny and Lee will run that and then will make themselves available for out-of-session conversations so that we have everybody up to speed with the requirements, especially the new ones. So welcome the new non-NRM groups to this session. I won't go through you all because it's I was going to, but I fear that I'll forget one and then you'll feel like you're not loved. So I won't try that. But welcome to these five new groups that we're working with in this project, as well as our theoretically 12 regional NRM organisations, albeit a couple aren't going to have funding under the new NRRP, so they won't probably be here today. But we're still encouraging all our players, all our members to use the statewide indicators framework. I just want to highlight that the statewide indicators framework has taken 4 or 5 years to get to this point from work from Penny, Lee and all the regional NRM organisations. So I want to acknowledge that because this is really Australia leading stuff. We've got a meeting straight after this with the Australian government who continually want to find out more about this framework as they're rolling out a new framework. So I don't want to underestimate the amount of effort and work that's gone into this to get us to the point we are at the moment. It has got ongoing development, and that's part of our funding for the next couple of years. But it has taken a lot of work to get to this point, and we're obviously encouraging everybody to use it because we need to be telling a better story of the impact of our government investment, both state and federal, ideally, in the state of Queensland. We're in a very competitive funding process, and we need to tell a very compelling story, and SWIFT is a major part of that. So I guess they're my opening words. Thank you all for making the time today, as I said, under tight circumstances, and I'll pass back to Penny and Lee.
Lee, thank you so much, Chris. Lee, could I just give you the opportunity to pop your face onto the screen so that people can see you, and if you'd like to introduce yourself very quickly, then that would be great.
Yep, hi, Lee Blacklock. I work with Penny and Chris, for Chris, with NRMRQ. My role is really supporting the spatial side, so the app development and the data roll-up to the statewide point. And I'll be available to help those using the tools or any needs in the spatial side to give me a call. So I will be available. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Given this is a webinar, as I said, I'm not going to go around and ask everybody to introduce themselves because there are a lot of people and we want to keep this as efficient and focused as possible. But I do encourage people to have a bit of a look at the list at some stage and start to familiarise yourselves with new names and organisations that are part of our broader family, our SWIFT family now, as Chris has mentioned. Just as a little bit of housekeeping, I think it would be helpful if everybody's able to mute themselves, but potentially also turn off their camera during the presentation, because I know that there are quite a few people who have got very narrow bandwidths, and I'm not sure because I'm not very technical, but I think the both ways of having cameras on is possibly exacerbates that issue. But Lee, can you hear me okay? Because I'm up in far north Queensland and I've probably got the worst.
Yeah, no, we can.
Bandwidth of anyone.
Your screen's okay. A little pixely, cool. But you're coming in okay.
All right. Well, I'm going to turn my camera off now. I'm going to share my screen with you, and we're going to move into start on a little bit more of a formal presentation. So here we go. Can everybody, Lee, can you see?
I can see your desktop. Yep, there you go.
And hopefully not too pixelated.
No, that's good.
You can see the presentation on the full screen?
Yep.
Cool. So welcome everybody to what we've been calling SWIFT 101. I'm going to say right up front that we're assuming limited knowledge of the Statewide Indicators Framework system in this webinar. So if you've been on this journey with us for the last 4 years and you think, oh, I got that wrong, feel free to drop off or just hang in there. You might have some wisdom to share as well, and there might be something new that you pick up as we go. I'm just going to give you a quick overview of the session as we have planned it today. So I feel like it's the sort of the why, what, how, show and tell, and where we've landed of the SWIFT. So we'll first talk a little bit about why we set about establishing it in the first place, what it is, the component, as well as its key characteristics, how it works, in particular what it means for the users, how it works for users. Then Lee, I'm going to hand over to Lee to do a bit of a show and tell of some of the spatial tools, which is the most exciting part of all this, the mapping, the Survey123 apps and the analysis system. We might have a little bit of a discussion about the result, although we're still waiting on the finalisation of the regional dashboards. And then at the end, we're just going to have a little bit of a discussion around where to from here in terms of regional visits and training and support opportunities. After the why, what and how, I will provide a little bit of an opportunity for people to ask questions of the broader framework. And I think Lee will do the same thing after his show and tell of the spatial tools. So if you do have questions, perhaps just store them up until we open up the opportunity. Okay, so the problem we were trying to solve several years ago at the end of the former state government program, which was the Queensland NRM program, a review was done of the impact of that program and the difference that it had made, and also some of its predecessing programs. And the summary finding was that we just don't know because we don't have any consistent data to verify, report or communicate the difference that program has made. We're sure it has. We're confident that it has made a difference. It's just that we're not in a strong position to provide this story on that difference. They wanted clarity in the next round of their investment, and so they set about seeking a mechanism to get a better handle on the difference that the investment was making. So the purpose of the Statewide Indicators Framework at its core is to tell a Queensland story, a Queensland NRM story that's consistent, credible, and compelling. I call them my three C's. Consistent, in that we're all collecting data in the same way to report on outcomes and deliverables that are articulated. So while there's always a lot of regional specificity in what we're doing, the broad general outcomes that we're delivering towards, that we're working towards, if we can be a little bit consistent, that helps us to be able to tell that statewide story. We want to be credible of a lot of narratives. We wanted some backup data. We wanted the data to be supported by trusted, reasonably trusted methods. And we wanted to make sure that there was a level of rigor about it that that enabled us to have confidence in that story. But mostly also we wanted the story to be compelling. We wanted to make sure that we are bringing to light the value of this investment, primarily because we want the investment to continue and we actually want it to grow. So that is the key purpose behind the Statewide Indicators Framework. I think it's really also important to be clearer about what the framework is not, and to be very, very clear about purpose. It is not monitoring. It's not empirical ecological monitoring. It is very much focused on telling
the story. Sorry, your screen's gone. Oh, it's right now. Went all pixely.
Oh, you're right. Bugger.
You're right.
Thank you, Lee. Tell me if that happens again.
Also, you're breaking up for me. I don't know whether other people are getting the same thing. I'm getting weird. This is Alan here. I'm getting a weird sort of breaking up and then fast forwarding.
Let me just try changing to my mobile phone hotspot and see if that makes a difference. Just hang on 2 seconds. In. Are you there?
Yep, we can hear you.
Okay. I don't know if that's going to be any better, but sincere apologies.
It sounds like it's going to be a bit more reliable. Let's see how we go.
So much for nationwide NBM. I'm just going to put my phone near the door. Hang on.
Yeah, no, it's sounding pretty good, Penny.
Okay, super. Right, am I back?
Yep.
Cool. So I was just mentioning, because this has come up quite a lot, about what the SWIFT and the SWIFT tools and the SWIFT monitoring is not. And it is not research and pure science. It was really important for us to be clear on purpose. While we believe that the data and information that is collected through this system could be useful to inform or supplement state of the environment or ecological monitoring, that was not our core purpose. The core purpose was to gather sufficient data in a particular area, a particular location where we are intervening, that gives us an indication that we are moving in the general direct trajectory of improvement. And it's really about being able to demonstrate the impact of that investment in a specific area. So you cannot extrapolate this to study the environment, you cannot extrapolate this data to the whole of the catchment. But in order to be able to meet those three C's, and to be able to provide a sense of trajectory, and for this to be affordable, I guess that's the main key point here, it needed to be good enough to provide a credible indication of trajectory, but it needed to be easy enough so that project teams could implement the framework, and you didn't have to engage science entities or botanists, for example, if you didn't happen to have them on your project team. It needed to be cost effective enough so that you could afford it within project budgets and you didn't find yourself spending 30 or 40% of your project on the monitoring. And it needed to be flexible enough to be applicable across the whole state. And that was very challenging for us. How do we set up a framework that works for Cape York, works for Southern Queensland, and works for reef catchments, for example? So, fit for purpose. So, that's the why behind establishing the State Wet Indicators Framework. Have we got a change screen there, Lee, to what?
Yes, Penny, we do.
Sorry, Penny, we do, yep.
So, the statewide indicators framework is a collaborative, flexible framework which underpins the monitoring of outcomes and deliverables for any investment program. We established this collaboratively across all the regional bodies who in Queensland. We wanted to make sure that it was modular so that you could expand its use to other programs above and beyond the Natural Resources Investment Program under which it was developed. It contains within it a suite of methods and data collection and analysis tools. So it's a framework, but it is the coat hanger, if you like, for a range of methods and tools that we've agreed we will all use across Queensland to ensure that we are reporting on our projects consistently. It's got five critical components that I'll step you through really quickly, and we can respond to questions on this later on. I don't want to overwork it. The first critical component out of the five is the logic. Now, this, what you see on the screen, is actually a screenshot from the NRIP program logic. The NRRP program logic is very similar and has similar components to it. But we will update all these visuals early in the new year. The investment program logic clarifies what success looks like for us across all of the projects that are engaging with this framework. And it also determines what we will measure to track the success, so the indicators. So it took us the longest time to simply agree on the program logic in the first place. Some key features of this particular program logic: it was built from the regions up. So it was built from the projects up. So we basically said to the regions, and we will do this early next year again, what would success look like for your program, for your project? And then we were able to find the common threads and the common ground and come up with a framework that resonated with all the projects. Every project had a home in the logic. We purposefully kept it very, very simple. Many people have seen logics which are a bit of spaghetti diagrams. Everything is in there. There's arrows all over the place. Everything's connected. And it's very, very hard to find your place in it. We kept it very simple so that we could agree on the simplicity at this point, because if we made it very, very complex, we would still be having conversations today about the complexity, how we reflect the complexities. Another feature of the logic is that we made a very, very clear distinction between the outcomes and deliverables. So you can see the red line, and we refer to the above the red line and below the red line components of the framework. The below the red line components that we call the deliverables are the things that you're paid to deliver. You have a reasonable amount of control over that because it makes up your workload, your work plan. So things like tackling threats, mitigating threats to particular vegetation or land condition assets. Things like improved practices. You have some control over that. You contract a landholder or you work with a landholder to change the way they do their practices. You put some more fencing in or some more watering points. You have some control. We've often reported on this stuff relatively well. How many hectares of weeds have we sprayed? What we have not necessarily reported on consistently and comprehensively is the difference that those deliverables made. So we have the above the red line outcome statements that we have kept very, very simple. And we have monitoring against those as well. So yeah, we might have done some threat mitigation work below the red line, but are we starting to see an improvement in the condition of our vegetation? Are we starting to see an improvement in the condition of our land, having dealt with and removed those threats? So you'll constantly hear me talking about the above the red line and the below the red line components. The above the red line is a bit more scary because we have far less control over that. There are many other factors that impact the condition of our land, our vegetation, our waterways, etc., including climate, wildfires, etc. So we have probably done less monitoring above the red line in the past, but that's the question that the government wanted answered. We invested in all these things, and did it actually make a difference to the condition of the vegetation or the land or the waterways? Okay, so that was component one. It's a really important one because it is the coat hanger off which everything else hangs in the end. The second component of the data collection methods, we did everything we could to use existing methods and to be consistent in the use of our methods. We needed the methods to be credible enough, but we also needed them to be easy enough. We needed them to be cost-effective enough, sensitive enough to pick up short-term changes. It's no point applying a monitoring method on a 3 or 4 year project that is not likely to demonstrate any change for 10 years because the attributes that you're measuring take so long manifest any changes. We also wanted these methods to be flexible enough so that it wasn't specific to rainforest or woodland or grassland, that they could be used across the state. So there are a range of methods. We've got the land condition assessment tool that was developed with support from the State Road Indicators Framework process by DAF. We've got WetCat, which was supported by which was produced by Queensland Wetlands Program, supported by the SWIFT. We have drawn on a lot of the reef tools, and we have also developed our own vegetation condition assessment tool, which used to be called BioCat, and now the new one is called VegCat. It is largely based on the Queensland Government's biocondition, but it is adjusted a little bit to meet our needs of being sensitive, cost-effective, and easy enough. So we have a range of methods. The third component are the smart tools. We could have stopped at methods and got everybody to send us Excel sheets and God knows what other kinds of products with data in them, but we went to the next stage of developing spatial tools that were consistent, that we hoped would make lives easier for people in the regions. I think it's fair to say that we were flying the plane while we were building it for quite a while there, Lee. So the poor people who were involved in being the guinea pigs of some of these tools, it might not have made their lives easier at times in the development process. But I think we are at a point now where the suite of tools are easy, they work, they're effective, and they deliver some really great value data, not only statewide, but also regionally. Lee's going to talk you through those tools in the next component of this webinar. But just to say, they use the ArcGIS Online platform. It's out of the box. All regional bodies have it. All organisations operating within the SWIFT are expected to have it or have access to it. Another key important feature of the smart tools is that data stays in the region, or it stays with the project proponent who is collecting the data. You enter it in and it stays in your system until you extract it out and send it off to someone else. We've made the most of existing tools where they exist. We have tools for the above the red line, condition change, outcomes change, and we have tools for below the red line for the deliverables. And we also have one tool for the people and communities component of the logic. So there's our lovely suite of tools that Lee will talk us through. The fourth critical component of the framework is the statewide analysis process. In order for our regional data to make sense statewide, we have built a suite of codes that analyze the data in a consistent way. They spit out CSVs or Excels that are consistent in their fields and in the way they go about analyzing the data that's fed in from your tools. Those codes that are run by the GIS people in the organizations, participating organizations, those codes enable us to then retrieve the data from each participating organization and roll it up statewide. If it wasn't for those codes, we would get a mishmash of I don't know what. So they've been a really important part of the system in its, as it's evolved. Fair to say there's been some teething problems with that, but I think we've got to the stage that they're working pretty well now. And of course, there are some key features. There's a bit of a snapshot of some of Lee's statewide mapping. The last component is the telling the story bit, which is the most important bit in the end. It's the cream on the cake, the thing that we can provide to investors that says, hey guys, look how amazing your investment is. What an incredible result you've achieved through that investment. At the moment, we've got a range of different types of reporting products. We've got a dashboard, a statewide dashboard. We've also got recently a report card, which is finished. This is not the finished version, which tells an incredible story about what the NREP program has delivered. We have never before had such a product. So we're pretty happy with that. So there you go. In summary, it's those five core components that make the SWIFT what it is. Miss one of those, it's like having a five-legged table. If you've only got four legs, the table is unstable and the coffee falls off. So just before I open up for a few more broader questions, I just wanted to give you a sense of some of the key characteristics of this framework. A really important aspect of it is that it has been developed collaboratively. It was an amazing partnership between the department and regional NRM organisations across Queensland. It was collaborative in its development. It was not just outsourced to a science entity to develop this. It was very, very much a partnership. And I think that has been critical to its success to date. But at the same time, there's been very strong regional commitment to the development of this framework. And for the non-regional organisation or for the non-regional body organisations listening in on this, I'm sorry that I keep mentioning regional bodies, but it has been such an important collective process for it. There's strong regional ownership over it, because of the involvement that regional bodies have had. NRM Regions Queensland hosts the framework and the tools on behalf of the regional NRM organisations, but we are making this open and available to any other organisation that participates in the NRRP at this point in time. Another key characteristic, as I've mentioned before, and I cannot tell you how critical this was, we definitely tried to keep it simple. That caused us some problems sometimes because suddenly we came across a curly problem that the simplicity of the framework struggled to resolve. But at each point in time, we tried to resolve it, maintaining the keep it simple principles. So once again, it's flexible and adaptive. We can bolt on another module if we have another outcome. We can adapt the tools or the methods if new and better methods come. That's all flexible. The most important thing, though, is that we all agree on any of those changes, and that whatever adjustments and modifications we make are collaborative and agreed. And so therefore that consistency continues to roll through. I guess the other key characteristics is that we tried to make it mainstream wherever possible. We didn't go out there and build ourselves new app frameworks. We used out-of-the-box products wherever possible, because we've all been had the experience of the fancy new app that's built, and then 3 or 4 years later it's no longer supported and it disappears, often with all of our data. So I just wanted, the next thing I'm going to talk very quickly about is how it works in reality. I'm going to do a quick summary of that, and then I'm going to open up for a few questions before I dig a little bit more into the detail. The most important part of this framework is the mapping and coding. The mapping and coding tells us what you're doing, where you're doing it, and why you're doing it. And the biggest challenge that we've had throughout this whole process is working with project teams to be very clear about exactly what you're doing, where you're doing it, and why you're doing it. Historically, people have used property boundaries to map their projects, even though they might only be working in one paddock or even in a subset of a paddock. We've been really, really clear that if you are claiming hectares through this system, hectares that have changed, you need to be very clear about the spatial location of where that change you hope has occurred. So most of the conversations we've had are about people providing clarity about the location, the specific location of their intervention, and then coding it with what they hope the change will be as a result of their intervention. So if we don't get our mapping right, then whatever hectares get rolled up in the analysis are no longer credible. So it's been so important that we are very clear right from the beginning about our what, where, and why. Once we're clear about our mapping and our coding of our project interventions, the end-to-end process of collecting data is supposedly relatively straightforward. In the field, you do your tree planting, or you do your threat mitigation, or you go out and you collect your VegCat data. You enter it into the app, so push submit, either in the field or when you get into range. It then feeds that data into a regional database or an organisational specific database if you're not a regional NRM body. The code that's been developed imparts some analysis on that regional data when it's run, and that provides a summary, a lot of information that gets sped up, spat out into, and sent to Lee to feed a statewide database. That then informs our fantastic statewide dashboards and reports, but it can also inform regional dashboards and reports. The data is equally valuable and valid for your own reporting, communications, and quality assurance processes. So I'm just going to hold off for a second, and I'm going to ask if anybody has any generic questions. I'm going to stop sharing my screen for the moment, if I can find out where to do it. Stop sharing. And I'll turn my camera on. So that was just a bit of a general overview. For those, particularly those newbies out there, do you have any general questions before we dig a little bit more deeply into how it works for you in the regions, and also how the spatial tools work with Lee? If you've got a question,
I have a question, Penny. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name's Louise Carroll, and I'm from Gundawindi. I'm from McIntyre Ag Alliance. How are you?
Hello. Lovely, Louise. Lovely to have you.
Yes, thanks so much for your information. I was just, my question is, our NRRP project is 6 events over 1.5 years. So they're like workshops or summits or field days. And so normally, so, you know, we're not planting trees or fixing gullies. We're having events with speakers where knowledge is imparted. And normally I would do a survey, you know, where you would rate your knowledge before and after the event about a certain thing that they're learning about at our event, and how likely are you to make any changes as a result of this new information, and those sort of questions. So is this something that can be captured, you know, how does my project work with this?
Thank you, Louise. That's a really good question. I'll just say something really quickly now, because I was going to dig a little bit more deeply into the people and community stuff a little bit further on. But absolutely, it's relevant, and a lot of the projects out there do events. The critical thing for us in a framework, the event is the thing below the red line, and evaluating the quality of the event and what people think of the event is really important information below the red line in terms of determining, you know, the success of that deliverable that you've got. What we will be asking people to do, and what the framework asks people to do, is to then do some follow-up assessment to determine whether or not those changes did happen, because that's the stuff above the red line. So yes, people have said that they are very likely to make changes. So we have an aspect of the people and communities component of the framework, which says, well, did it happen? What changes were put in place as a result of this event? So I'll talk a little bit more in detail, and we do have an app for that. We have an app for those follow-up surveys, Louise. So of course, you're more than happy to have an app for the event itself to evaluate your workshop itself. And we could probably even work on a consistent app for that if that's something you're interested in. But what we really want to know is, 6 months, a year down the line, did those intended changes happen? And I guess that's what the Survey 123 People and Communities app asks for the above the line component. So I can talk a little bit more in detail about that later on if you like, Louise. Hi. Thanks. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, thank you, Penny. And just finally, does the app, are they set questions, or do I have to make up the questions?
For the above the red line app, did anything change for you? Did the earth move when you got back to your home farm, whatever it is? What differences have these actually practically made? They are set questions. But they are a short set of questions that you can embellish and add to, obviously, if you've got more things you'd like to ask people as a follow-up.
Thank you.
Thanks. Liz, do I see your hand up there? Hello, Liz.
Hey, Penny. How are you doing?
Good.
Good to see you. It's been ages. Yeah. I just put a couple of questions into the chat, so I'm really interested to understand how organisations outside the NRM regional bodies are getting involved with SWIFT, because I think there's real capacity for expansion and to have contractors, potentially landholders, community members using SWIFT if they've got provided the right training. So that to me would enable capture of a much broader range of activity. But maybe some of them would be outside the actual funded activities through the NRM program. So I'm just wondering, it just comes back to, I think Bronwyn's put something in the chat about that. How do we link this amazing system that's been developed in Queensland to be broader and to capture more stuff? So, and how does it link to, you know, what we do for the feds through the merit system, and how does it link to TURN, and how does it link to Eco Commons and all of that stuff? I mean, I think it's a nice high-level discussion that needs to to happen with, you know, between maybe Chris and is it Kate Andrews that's in, you know, Regions Australia and the folk at Turn. Anyway, any answers?
Oh, look, I can start, and maybe Chris wants to mention something after this. Look, we always envisaged that, for me, if this was used more broadly across Queensland by other entities, and across Queensland we were all consistently considering, one, the way we describe our success, and two, the way we monitor and collect data about that success, both above the red line and below the red line, I mean, that would just be amazing. So maybe there is a long-term vision there. At the moment, it's been limited to NRM regional organisations. But I guess now with the advent of the NRRP, this is the opportunity we have to figure out the mechanics for how it's expanded to other organisations. So I probably don't have the answer in terms of how, Liz, right now, but I definitely have the answer in terms of, you know, that we would really, you know, we are thinking deeply about this now. In a technical sense, providing somebody has access to ArcGIS online, there is no technical barrier for them to be able to collect the data in a consistent way. There's nothing stopping people from doing LCAT assessments, because LCAT, Land Condition Assessment Tool, as a method, is broadly available to anybody that wants to do it. So there's nothing stopping people from taking components of the program, of the framework, and using them. But I guess it's about how we get the consistency, the quality assurance, so we know that the data is reasonably good, and how we would most make value out of more organisations collecting the data by being able to bring that Queensland story together. So those are some of the questions that we're probably grappling with at the moment. Lee or Chris, do you want to add anything to Liz's question?
Yes, I will. Pen, I've actually just put something in chat. So great questions from Bronwyn and Liz. I guess I've been in this game for 30 years, and so I had many cycles of seeing these trends come through. So, and I'm an ex-Southern Stater. I used to say Victorian, but people don't like that, so I say Southern Stater, and have been through many cycles with the Commonwealth Government on these things. So that's why we're working so hard with them to try to work out a way that we can align this to their current requirements. The challenge they have is they are running a national program which involves all the states, and all the states do something slightly different. But they, as they say to me, they hold the money. And I'm saying, yeah, you hold the money, but the reality is this keeps happening in cycles. Why can't we think smarter about how we align different methodologies, even if we can't use the identical one? So we're doing that. The Queensland stuff, yeah, we started some conversations. We've had a meeting with LGAQ, and we've had a meeting with QWOC. But again, this still needs a lot of resources. So whilst Penny and Lee provide a really good summary, it does need a lot of resources behind this, a lot of coordination, because like all programs, shit data in means shit data out. And we've got to really make sure that this is credible. So this is the start of a conversation with the newbies today. But you just think about expanding that up, the complexity of making sure the data is actually credible and that we can hold our hand to our heart and say, this is the story of Queensland. It is the trajectory we're on, and we're more than happy to keep working with groups and looking for opportunities to really resource this up, because this ultimately is the story for Queensland, as Penny said and I said at the start. This would be a very exciting space to be in 5 to 10 years if we can tell a really compelling story of all NRM investment in Queensland. We need the ministers to get excited by this. And we've had lots of goers at this, and Penny's report that she's done for NRIP with Helena and her team is a really great product. We're working with their comms team to actually get it out and circulate it, because it is a great story, and it's lost amongst a lot of other communications. But we've got to get ministers excited by this. That's probably our first step, and then resources might follow. Thanks, Penny.
Thank you, Chris. Lee, did you want to add anything?
No, I think you've covered that pretty well.
Just on the federal government side of things, and as Chris said, we've actually got a meeting with them after this to talk about the specifics of what they're going to require us to collect and can we maximise alignment, because in the end, vegetation condition is vegetation condition, whether the federal government wants you to collect information or the SWIFT requires it, it's still the same type of information. Let's not blow our opportunity for consistency because of a couple of ways of describing things that are not consistent. So we're aiming to do whatever we can for maximum consistency with the federal government system. That's one of the reasons that we have been very, very clear on purpose, because our experience from the conversations to date, Chris, I think you'd agree with this, is I think they are leaning much more in their long-term monitoring program towards ecological environmental monitoring as opposed to programmatic monitoring. And so we're trying to be really, really clear that they are not the same thing and they often have different underpinning requirements and characteristics. So we're just trying to get as much clarity as we can. So watch this space. We've come this far. Oh, my God. Okay. Are there any other questions in the chat? I'm just skimming through. Anybody else wanting to put their hand up for a question at this point of time? Cool. I'm just going to flip across to another PowerPoint and try not to take too long with it. But I did want to give you a sense of how this rolls out for project proponents. I sometimes will say regional bodies. You'll have to forgive me for accidentally always referring to regional bodies. People who are getting NRM project funding, this is what the framework looks like for you in terms of the data collection requirements, etc. So you remember our five components. A lot of what I'm going to talk about now is the smart tools for the regions, because that's the bit that we have built very much with regions in mind, thinking about how can we make it possible for you to collect this data in a systematic, consistent, reasonably rigorous and transparent way. So there's a slide here that's looking at the components of the framework and the key purpose of the of those components. Now, I know I said there are five components, but that orange one, the smart tool, has, let's say, some sub-components within it that I think it's worthwhile digging into now. So we've got right at the bottom there, the mapping and the coding. And I think I mentioned how critical that is, because if you don't map your project area accurately and code it according to, one, what you're doing there, your deliverable, but also why you're doing it, your outcome. If you don't code it correctly, then we've lost consistency before we've lost credibility and consistency before we've even started monitoring. So that's such a fundamental part of this. The next one up is the data collection tools, the Survey 123 apps that Lee has built, which are there to ensure credibility of the data and that it's collected consistently. The next one up, the little munchkin man here, are the smart analysis tools. That's the Python script that we've had built by Esri to do the analysis of the data that you've submitted through your data collection tools. And the next thing up are the regional reports that we are generating templates for as we speak. So it's so important that if we're going to have a system like this, that the people who are collecting and storing the data actually also use the data. Otherwise, it's not of value to you. If it's only seen as something you must do to send the data up to the investor, then I think it has a limited life, because as soon as that investment's gone, you'll ditch it. It's really important for us that we create value in this system and in this product for you more generally. Then we've got the statewide roll-up systems that Lee will talk about in the blue and the statewide reports. So these are all subcomponents, if you like, of those smart tools that we have. We keep calling them smart tools because we are sure they should be, and they must be, and they will be. That these are the four components that live within that orange box. So in summary, if you have mapped your project and coded it to grazing land condition, because the work you're doing is about trying to get an improvement in the condition of that grazing land, here it is. This is your home in the logic. This is how it works. You're going to map your project. You're going to map it accurately. It's not about mapping the property. It's about mapping the site where you can hold your hand on your heart and say, I reckon because of my project, we're going to get improvement there. You map it and you code it according to both its outcome and the deliverable that you're doing, the action that you're doing. So it could be improved practices, it could be threat mitigation. Right, we've mapped it beautifully. That doesn't tell us whether or not we made a difference. That just tells us that we anticipate we will make a difference. So we need some monitoring tools to verify that that difference has happened or is we're on a trajectory to that difference happening. For land condition, the specified monitoring data method and tool is LCAT. So out you go into the field, you collect your LCAT data in your baseline year, you go back the next year to the same plot and you collect the data again the following year to start to see if there is some improvement. The next component, as we've talked about, are the Python scripts. This is the ESRI code that the GIS people in your organisation run at particular times of the year to analyse your LCAT data. And what those tools do is they analyse your LCAT plots and they combine it with your project mapped area to provide some statistics on how much improvement there has been over what area. We've got regional reports already. Every plot will deliver a regional report out of Survey 123. You can give it back to the landholder. You can have it on record in your organisation. All the photos that you took will be in it. But we've also got some summary templates as well, which summarise your plot data, provide you with useful stats about how much improvement there's been over time. And Lee and I are in the process of developing interactive dashboards in Power BI that will actually automate some of that analysis for you and give you some really great tools for slicing and dicing your data, looking at it according to subcatchment or according to regional ecosystem, if you like, or according to program or landholder ID. So I think there's a lot of interesting information that is going to come through for you through those dashboards. And then obviously you've run the code and it gets sent up to Lee or to NRM Regions Queensland to be cobbled together in the statewide dashboard. And out of that, we get our beautiful reports. So that's grazing land condition. But what if your project's about vegetation? Here, you live in this part of the logic. You do your mapping. Obviously, it's not the same map, but you will map your project area that you are confident will have some sort of improvement from your work. So it's the area that you are anticipating you'll see a response in from your tree planting or your threat mitigation or you're managing the weeds or whatever you're doing there, or you're excluding livestock from your beautiful riparian area. It's the area that you think will demonstrate an improvement in the condition of the vegetation. But once again, we just need to be able to verify that. We need to be able to say, yep, from the beginning of the project to the end of the project, we can start to see an improvement in canopy cover or ground cover or the extent of the threat of the weeds or natural recruitment, etc. The method that we have consistently to collect that data is VegCat, and we have a lovely Survey 123 app to collect the data. And then we've got our smart code, which analyzes that data, intersects it with your polygon, and spits out some results. Ah, then we also have some regional reports on that data. It gets fed up to the statewide system, Lee stitches it together, and we get our statewide reports. And that is basically the same process for every outcome within the logic. If it's wetlands, you'll be using WetCat. And we have got a script for that and regional reports, etc. for wetlands. So that's all very well. That's all the stuff above the red line. For the stuff below the red line, we've also got apps for that. So it's the same mapping, because when you map this, you said, ah, oh, this is land condition as an outcome, but what we're doing there is improved practices. So it is the very same map that drives our data around improve our deliverables under the red line, our improved practices. We actually have an app to be able to monitor what changed in those practices. We've got smart analysis tool, which determines the change over time for those practices. We even have regional reports and regional dashboards almost ready to send out to you. And it gets rolled up to the statewide system in the same way as the land condition or veg condition, and it informs our dashboards. If we're doing threat mitigation, and it's exactly the same process. Get your mapping right, get your coding right, use your threat mitigation app, run the script. GIS people running the script once every 6 months when you have to report, or even more often if you'd like to for your own purposes, regional reports, and it gets rolled up statewide. So as you can see, the end-to-end process, collect your data in the field, it goes into your database, it gets analysed by the Python script, it gets sent statewide for the reports, and it can be used for your regional dashboards as well. So just a very quick word on the people and communities component. We've talked about this already. As we said, Louise, before, we've got outcomes that are specific to people and communities. And it's not about them appreciating the knowledge that they've gained through that workshop, or believing that their knowledge is improved, or thinking that they're going to make a change. It is actually about them having applied that change when they got home. So we've got our capacity building and engagement events below the red line, and it's fabulous to monitor those and to have some app data on those. But the important thing is that we're able to report consistently about whether or not they had an impact, because what we need is to be able to convince the investors that they were worthwhile and that we should do more of them. Or maybe we'll find they weren't worthwhile and we shouldn't do more of them. The important thing is that we are seeking to figure out the impact of those workshops. We have a form which is consistent. It has several questions on it. We have an app that replicates those questions, and we have a people and communities guide, which we will need to update, but it's still pretty current. It's got NRIP written all through it, but I will be updating that to be program blind. And for the first time ever, we have got some consistent data on the extent to which the people that we have worked with are satisfied, have benefited from, and have made a change as a result of the projects that we've been doing. So I'm going to stop there, stop sharing my screen. I'm just going to, as a touchstone, touch base with people to see if they have any questions, to see if you have any questions on that slightly deeper dive that we just did. I'm just having a look. Keith. So Keith is talking about that the people and communities component, and that we spoke of feedback at a workshop and then follow-up data captured from workshop attendees to show any changes that have resulted. How do you propose this occur? Who will undertake the post-workshop monitoring, and who pays the task data uploading? In previous workshops, You've had about 100 attendees, a huge amount of work in this. That the answer to that, Keith, is that's your enterprise's decision, how you would like to go about it. We don't prescribe how you will go about that follow-up monitoring. I understand it is good and best practices that you do follow-up monitoring to figure out whether or not you had an impact. It in some cases, people have done it through one-on-one phone discussions with attendees 6 months or a year down the line. In other cases, people have done field visits to their workshop attendees. The bottom line in the end is if you don't do that, you never know whether you made an impact and whether you made a difference. So it's something you just have to think of how you factor into your work planning process. And we could talk in more detail about mechanisms for that. What the app does is just make it simple to capture that information, the analysis. Then you, all you actually need to do then is send an Excel extract from that data to me or Lee or whoever's coordinating the SWIFT at reporting time. So there is not a lot of analysis that's required, but it's critically important information for your own enterprise purposes anyway. So does that answer your question, Keith?
Yeah, to an extent, Penny. I was just trying to get a handle on whether it's going to be in-field data capture, like could be an LCAT versus a telephone survey.
It is a people survey. It's not a bank survey.
Okay.
So you are not claiming to have made any change over any hectares. So your land condition change for your project essentially is zero. You can't claim a verified land condition change anywhere. One, because you haven't mapped your area of impact and you haven't gone out and monitored it before and after the change. If you were entering into a contract with a landholder and investing money with the landholder to install fencing or watering points, then you would be very much wanting to map the area before and the area after to determine whether or not that improved practices investment has made a difference. In this case, you will be asking them whether or not they've done something different, and you'll be asking for information on that, but you'll not be monitoring that difference. And also, fairly enough, you won't be claiming it either. Does that make sense, Keith?
Yeah, that's fine, Penny. Good on you. Thank you.
I would say telephone is okay. It's the minimum. If you're able to get out and visit a few of these participants and have a chat with them around the kitchen table, obviously that is a better way to do it, even if it's just a proportion of them. But a one-on-one telephone interview would be a minimum. I don't think an email survey is going to be ever going to be effective, because you're only going to ever hear from the people that can be bothered to respond. So just have a think about what you're wanting to claim and how credibly you can back it up with data.
Thank you.
Thanks, Keith. Any other questions on the general framework and how it operates from a region's from a project organisation's perspective at this point in time, either by putting your hand up or popping something into the chat? Oh, thank you, Liz. It's always rather hard to step people through this, but Louise, I see you have your hand up. Please go ahead.
Thanks, Penny. I was wondering, this project ends in June, I think, next year. So is this when is this reporting due? Is it in June or?
I would be suggesting in June, yes, next year, Louise, absolutely. It depends when you are planning in your reporting on claiming anything as a result of your events.
Okay, so if you have an event in May, then how will you seek how the impact that is made post-event if it's due in June?
Look, can you do that? I just think you have to balance it. Maybe you can do a follow-up at the end of June, but clearly maybe you would slightly adjust your questions. You'd say, now you've got back to your farm or whatever, your home, your property. Noted in your evaluation that you were a bit inspired to do some changes. Do you have anything planned? Has anything happened? Do you have anything concrete planned over the coming period? So I think you just have to be a little flexible in thinking about how can I demonstrate value? Or not. Maybe they say, oh, look, not, I got home and it's just not quite right for me. Well, then you'd really want to know what's not going to work for you. What are the remaining obstacles that you feel are insurmountable? You'd want to know that in the end. So does that make sense, Louise?
Yeah, thank you. And I have one more question. If what percentage, say we have 100 people at an event and I want to do it's easier to get, you know, everyone at the event to fill out a survey or a large proportion of them to do it. But then post-event, what's the percentage of people that you want a follow-up survey done? Like, is it 10% or?
To be perfectly honest, we are not prescribing that level of detail. If there's 100 people at an event, 100 people at an event, then it's an enormous event. It's going to cost you a lot to plan for it, prepare it, to run it. If there's 100 people there, it's going to be a lot of speakers, etc. You've got to be quite clear in advance of why you're holding the event. What change are you trying to impart in people from that event? Because in the end, it all boils down to something to do with the natural resources. So you've got a bit of a sense of, look, this is the change we're after from, you know, as many of these 100 as possible. Look, my sense is that if you've put that much investment into a large event, I would be having a commensurate investment in trying to demonstrate that it was worthwhile. And, you know, it's not a reporting requirement in the sense of tick a box. It's about understanding the impact of your event post-event and whether or not it made a difference, whether it's worth doing it again. How do I convince the investor that it was actually meaningful and that it made a difference, that people have gone away and done something different, particularly for this type of investment, which isn't actually just about nice events. It's about whether or not those events actually impart a response in what people do at home. So, look, if you've got a big event like that, it would be at least 10% of the investment that you've put into that event should be invested in monitoring whether or not it made a difference. So if that means 50% of the respondents get a telephone call or a couple get a visit, I would invest in it, to be honest. It's your bread and butter in many ways. Does that make sense, Louise? We pretty much said you should be allocating 10% of your project budget to monitoring, not necessarily meaning a post-workshop, at the end of the workshop event survey, but for monitoring. So, cool. Does that make sense, Louise?
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you.
I will call on Kate or one of the other RLOs to provide their perspective on this in terms of their expectations, because we've not had projects which are really only events before that are not actually going to be claiming a natural resources outcome. But I'll someone's got their hand up in the 17. Duncan.
Yeah, thanks, Penny. You can hear me, can you?
I can.
Yeah, cool. Just a quick one. I just clarifying in relation to the grazing practice change one, you had the LCAT for under the red line, but they're above the red line, that other form aspects. No,
LCAT is above the red line, Duncan. LCAT is the land condition assessment tool. So LCAT doesn't care what you did. It doesn't care who paid for it. It's just looking at the condition of your land, a bit like VegCAT. So it's the above the red line tool.
Okay, so flip that around. Sorry. So the below the red, you said that other one. So familiar with the LCAT and that monitoring on the ground, but the other form, was that really just sort of capturing the project details, so to say, whether they're going from set stocking to sort of rotational, stream bank, wet season spelling, etc., is it? Okay, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. It's the improved practices. It's the stuff that you've got more control over. And one of the reasons that we have a form for that and we have an analysis system behind that form is lots of people have been reporting in the past, oh, we got all these lovely improved practices, but no one's, we haven't had a system to verify it or determine, well, how improved is it? Is it improved from 40 to 50 out of 100 or from 40 to 80 out of 100? You know, how significant is this improvement? So, Dunk, we have drawn on the reef questions for the grazing tool that we use. But the other reason that we think it's very important is we may not see a verifiable land condition improvement in the 3 or 4 years of a project because we may have a very severe drought and therefore things may go backwards. But if that happens and we've got an explanation for that, at least below the red line, we can say, look, this is why things have gone backwards. It's out of our control. But we're confident that the investment was worthwhile because we've got these improved practices below the red line happening. And therefore, as weather controlled influences start to even out, we're confident that over time we're going to have a better land condition result. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. No, it's good. Just clarity for me, and I could probably give an example. We've just gone out and done LCATs for this year's starter project. It's a very good year, very wet year. So the likelihood of seeing improvement in the LCAT, it's probably not going to happen. So that metadata or, you know, project data is going to be very relevant for us to justify. So cheers.
And we know land condition improvement is a long-term initiative, but at least we should be starting sometime. We can't not do it because we say, oh, there's not going to be no change. We have to at least start with something. So, Kate, could I ask you to just respond on your, I don't want to be saying different things to what the department's saying in terms of that above the line impact monitoring from the people and communities events. Do you just want to confirm or otherwise your expectations around that, or Deb or somebody else from the department?
I think what you've said is right, Penny. And for those I haven't met, I'm Kate Cumming. I'm one of the regional liaison officers with the department. We're not being prescriptive around that, about how many X percentage of those you should be following up with. It'll be a case-by-case basis. And I think just continuing to liaise with your regional liaison officer, we can give some more guidance if this is too generic in this forum. But again, we're not prescriptive. Unless there's something quite prescriptive in your individual project plan, otherwise the guidance that Penny's provided that's good, Penny. Thank you.
What I would say is if you're not going to survey everybody that came, and it depends on the size of your event and the scale of what you're hoping to achieve from it, if you are going to only do a sample, whether it be 20 or 30 or 40 or 10%, whatever it is, I mean, 10% of 100 is only 10 telephone calls, so it's pretty minimal, I would have thought. If you're only going to do a proportion, you must ensure that it's a random selection. If you're going to extrapolate that to the broader participants. So that will be the main thing. So, yep, cool. So no other questions on what we've done so far.
There's a few in the chat there, Penny, I think.
We've been monitoring some control sites where nobody does anything. Okay, so, Catherine, this is a real... I'll go to Catherine first. It's a very, very good question, and we've been going backwards and forwards on control sites. At this point in time, the SWIFT does not require a control site. It is more a matter of what the condition was before in the baseline, and for that those very same plots, what it is afterwards. If you would like to do control sites where there's no intervention, we don't say you can't do that. The system does not roll it up, but you're absolutely welcome to do it. The problem that we often have is that the control, finding an absolute like with like for the control sites is very problematic. Finding something that is exactly the same as where you're intervening and where you're doing your monitoring, that's in an area where you're not intervening and that will respond in, you know, the same way as your site would have responded without intervention, is quite challenging in itself. So at the moment, the system does not do that. We would like to think that the quality of your data was such that you did sufficient plots within your intervention to have confidence that the summarized result is a reasonable reflection on what's really happened. One plot in a 1,000 hectare project site is just not enough. So we would really like people to invest in making sure that there is enough monitoring plots representatively spread around your project site in order to have some confidence that the data is credible and representative of what's happening in your site. Alan's gone. Alan Hoggett has been with us from the very early days. So Tony O'Malley asks, if you do 1 hectare of re-veg in the middle of extensive cleared area versus 1 hectare in the middle of a wildlife corridor, does this system recognise this? No, it doesn't, Tony, because, and you're talking about landscape context there, the value of that area in the middle of a wildlife corridor is clearly higher than the value of the 1 hectare in the middle of a cleared paddock. Although some people would argue that the area in the one in the middle of the paddock might be more valuable. But really what you're mapping is the area that you are imparting a change over. So that's what you're claiming. You're claiming 1 hectare. The context of the value of that condition improvement in that 1 hectare is in your narrative. So if you can argue the case that that 1 hectare that you located your project in is highly valuable for whatever reason, that's where you impart that information. But for us, when we're rolling it up, 1 hectare is 1 hectare. It's gone from this improvement to this improvement. You may find that you get a more rapid improvement, so your score is much greater between your baseline and your end of project score, because you get your re-veg is more supported by your surrounding forest in that you're getting the seeds and the birds, etc. So you may get a better score in the end, but the veg cat is really only looking at that point on the ground and is not considering its context. Does that make sense, Tony? Okay. Parise from DCCA. Parise, who are we? I should know that. Desert Channels.
Dawson Catchman.
Thank you. You don't have a GIS expert internally. Are you able to provide instruction on how to extract the required GIS data from the system? So when you put your application in, one of the criteria for you getting the money was that you had the base GIS expertise to operate within the SWIFT, or that you were in a position to access it, or that you budgeted to be able to access it from another entity. So
we have budgeted to access it. I'm just wondering if you can put us in touch with who that, do you have people who we can use, or we just use the local NRMs, or what's your recommendation?
Well, you could approach your local NRM. They might be interested in taking on some, you know, contracted work. I don't know who's in your area.
FBA.
FBA. Okay. You can have a conversation with them, or there may be other organisations that offer contract services with GIS. We are assuming base understanding of ArcGIS and the capability with mapping, use of the system, but we will provide instruction on how to use the SWIFT tools themselves, how to run the code. That's the work Lee will do. So Lee will provide support for operating within the SWIFT system from the GIS perspective. He won't provide base GIS training, but no, he absolutely. Yeah, is that okay, Lee? Does that make sense to you?
Oh, sorry, Penny. Yeah, yep. That okay. would be most operational.
Cool. And so speaking of, you know, speaking of Lee, or there's a little bit of a segue there over to you, to Lee. I wanted to dedicate the rest of this session to Lee to give you a little bit of a show and tell and a look at some of those smart tools. And bearing in mind, this is just a Swift 101. We'll come back at the end and talk about the follow-up support that we can offer from here on in. So, hey, Lee, over to you. Are you good?
Yeah, thanks, Penny. Yep, I'll share my screen. And I'll have to ask you if it's clear enough. Can you see that okay, Penny?
That's really clear to me, hopefully to everyone else as hopefully well. I've got both screens there, Lee.
Yeah, I put both on that just so I can flick back and forward if necessary. So I won't bore you too much with detail, but I'll just go through roughly what a process would be and what we've got and what you can use and how it's done, I suppose. So obviously a project starts with a project area. So I might just bring in something that might look like that. So you capture your polygon over the area where you're actually the work is being done. We'll provide an empty geodatabase for those who aren't spatially orientated, I suppose. It's an ArcGIS format that basically a container for all data. So I've already pre-configured a database. Penny mentioned some of the attributes that are key, and we have things like the polygon ID, so it's a unique identifier. Penny mentioned deliverables, the outcomes, obviously the project area, and a lat and long of a coordinate where the project is based. They're sort of the foundation that we need to locate a project. And that has to be as accurate as you can create and build. So what happens then basically is over however many projects you have, they expand. I've just got the statewide version here just to show. So in the roll-up process, they all get rolled together into a statewide component. Now, within the app-wise, over here, we've gone with Survey 123. We mainly went that way because LCAT, which is the Land Condition Assessment Tool, it was built by DAF, as Penny mentioned. It's the largest app on the planet for Survey 123, and it creates an awful lot of data in here. I won't go into it because it does go through many pages of information. The beauty about the Survey 123 tools are that you can go just to a standard web interface. I'll just expand this a little bit. And you can look at the results of all the data that you've captured. So my LCAT NRMRQ, which is a test area that I've got, I'll just go down to it. It's here. I can look at the data. So basically, you can go out in the field, capture a record, send it to the database, and within 5 seconds, it will populate your data set. So it's captured the data. Then you can interrogate that data. So if I clicked on a record, and this is the area that I live at the moment, you can see where the data that I've actually collected, any photos that you've taken as well, they're all in that data. So that's the beauty about it. You can capture data, display it at any time. So we have LCAT for land condition. We have the Improved Grazing Practices Tool. That's the one Penny mentioned there that you go through a series of questions, answer those. You'll see we have location, off-stream watering points, the length of fencing for the project, and then you answer a whole lot of standardized questions, and we can run some analysis over that, which gives us a score. Okay, I won't go any further with that one. We have a revegetation app. So that's basically there to collect data. Again, below the red line information, anything you do out in the field. One thing these are really useful for is that you might go out in the field today, tomorrow, you capture the information. When it comes time to reporting, in 6 months' time, a lot of people, and me included, forget the details of it. Well, you can record this in that app. Once you send the data, it's available to you at any time to go back. So we do have the tools that will roll up all that data, but critical information stored within this app as well. So it can be a really good tool to capture as you go. Okay. We have a stream bank gully tool, same sort of thing. It collects location, the date, the categories, just information that's related to stream bank and gully project work, sediment savings, those sort of things. Okay, another tool we have is a threat mitigation. So this is a one that basically what you've done out in the site, what mitigation, what threat type, that could be a range of those. One thing is that if you find something that's different but you would like included in this, these apps are quite easy to modify or to add. So, you know, we've only gone through what we've got with NRIP, but there might be more things you come across that could be useful to everybody. So we're quite willing to look at modifying the app to suit your needs. So threat mitigation, there's a whole lot of information there that we record. And again, the apps will, the Python script will roll that data up into a standardized output. We have the people and community survey. Now this one we've got basically doesn't collect the location just because we didn't need it to, but in the background there is some information recorded. This will be available later, so it's really satisfaction project. There's plenty of room for comments. I won't go into details with this. There might be questions you want to add in there as well. We can do that. That's no real trouble. Okay. The VegCat. This is one that wasn't straight off the shelf. This one was built, used to be called BioCat. BioCat had some issues with that. So we modified this one to make life a lot easier for everyone using it. And for those who capture vegetation data, we have benchmark regional ecosystem data. You get a choice of that. If you don't have benchmark data, which some people don't, you can actually put in the interim attribute values. So you might know what they would be, and you can actually include them in there instead of a lot of Queensland don't have benchmarks, probably 50 or 60%. Don't. So if you're a specialist in vegetation, you would be able to associate those and code them, that you're the one who actually created that. And we have a different vegetation recording methods. We have a VegCat method, or you might have had somebody else do a different survey type and they've got an alternative method. We didn't want to exclude people just because of that. And we have also WetCat. At the moment, I've called it the one for Des. it's almost completed to their standard, just a little bit of wording they want added, but it's quite a beast in itself. Survey 123, you can input data from a computer, but you can also take it in field to either a laptop or a tablet or a phone. The screens on the phones obviously aren't that big, and when you use a monster like Wetcat, there's a lot of text in it. That's what they wanted. There's links here to their policies and documents as well. So that's Wetcat. It goes on and on and on, but it is what it is. Okay, so they're basically the apps that are available that we use, depending on what your project is, and you actually get to capture the data and view it live. You can download the data as well. You can print out reports. We have some built for LCAT. We're looking at VegCat. Penny's working on a VegCat one at the moment, and the others will be available down the track as well. Okay, Penny.
Is it worth just quickly going into LCAT and showing them a report, or even the old BioCat report, Lee, and just showing people the type of reports
out? Okay, I can go and see if they're working.
This is the old BioCat, so replaced by VegCat. But you can see that.
So I'll I'll go to your area, Penny.
Oh,
we want to see your feet.
This is Lee's test file. So yeah.
So I need test site. So when we get Esri to do work, Penny mentioned about the data is regional data. So I can't actually see all the data that's located within the regions. It stays within the region. The regions are custodians of that data, and all that I get for a statewide roll-up is a number of CSV files, which are they desensitize the data to some extent, so I don't actually know the actual location of the projects. That's the difference, I suppose, between this process and any other process I know, is that most places they try and centralize data. This one's different. Okay, so the idea with the Survey 123 web tool is you can do a report on a template that you load, and then you can actually produce an output of that.
Lee, is that the right template? If you use the proper, that's probably the wrong
template. Oh, might be. It'll tell me in a second.
That'll just be the standardized Survey 123 one, maybe.
Oh, well, okay.
Maybe not.
It'll do it. Probably take a few seconds. While it's doing that.
The other thing you can do with this is you can export all your data into a CSV or an Excel file really easily if you just want to play around with it.
Yep, that's right.
Penny and Lee, it's Liz. Sorry. I'll put it in chat, but seeing as we've got a bit of a break, you mentioned that regional NRMs get all the data, but if the data's not collected, like if it's being collected by another organisation as allowed, I think, under NRRP, does the regional NRM body still get the data?
No.
The
project owner is the owner of the data. So, yeah, so, well, it's whoever's ArcGIS system it's collected on, Liz. So clearly if an organisation that doesn't have their own system contracts Health and Animal Water, for example, to collect the data for them, it will go onto Health and Animal Water system. But if there's an entity out there that has their own system and is independent, then the data will remain with that entity. Is that correctly?
Yep.
But when you assimilate the data up upwards, is it possible then for an NRM to say, can you give me a copy of all the output that's in my region, whether it's our organization's data or other users' data?
Well, they could ask, but it's not theirs to just see, because they want to. They'd have to negotiate with you as the custodian of the data and also the owner of the data, who would be the property owner that you're on.
There's two levels here, though, I think, Lee. One is what gets rolled up statewide is publicly available for anybody to view. So if you want to know within a particular NRM region what's going on, or within a particular local council, you can look at it at that statewide level. But that data's been desensitized, so you don't know exactly what location it's, you know, exactly which land holding it's on. In terms of the detailed data that sits underneath it, like the VegCat scores and all of those sorts of bits of information, you'd need to get the permission of the person who owns the data.
I might just just touch on that a bit further, that the point locations of what's going to be shown publicly. Now, within the data that the geodatabase has collected, I mentioned earlier that they have a latitude and longitude. Now, that lat and long is a point that I want people to give me where they want that record to show up. Now, in this case, we've got a tree. Now, that might not be the actual location of the project. The project might be somewhere else. So I want people to be comfortable that any data that's going to be shown publicly is desensitized enough that you can't locate that property directly unless it's allowed. So all these projects where you see the dump truck, where there's a sediment project and land condition and vegetation, aren't necessarily in exactly those points. We do ask people that they actually fall within the local authority and within the state electoral boundary, because there's a lot of questions come up about, you know, which local authority these projects are actually in. But those locations are probably not where the project is actually sitting. Is that okay? Is that help with?
I'm just sort of exploring that idea, because up until this latest round of funding, I guess it was only the regional NRMs that were using SWIFT. So this expansion just means that, I guess, as a regional NRM, we just want to try and understand. And I was thinking about what the application of this system and trying to understand what's going on in our region, so those future discussions we've talked about. So it just seems that, you know, there's many players, you know, particularly in our space, maybe in Southeast Queensland. There's lots of people doing lots of stuff. And as a regional NRM, in terms of trying to manage and consider what effort on NRM plan targets is happening across the region, just sort of exploring what capacity would a tool like this have to sort of feed into, well, we know these projects are happening, you know, or how many projects, what is the community effort, how could it? So I think that's something I expect most of the regions in Queensland and across Australia would be challenged by, is trying to manage overall effort. And I say community effort, I mean everybody, whether it's local government, state government, community groups, contractors, us, landholders, in a space. How do you map that effort to understand what's going on in your region? And how would we know if we've got somebody working in a space that we're trying to work in? I mean, you hope your communication systems are really cool, but sometimes we get challenged with timeframes, for example, and developing projects that you're not aware that somebody's developing a parallel project to you until afterwards, you know?
Look, it's a chronic problem. And obviously we can't do anything about, you know, different people developing projects at the same time, or different projects being awarded and knowing what those projects are. That stuff is usually public information, though, on the investor's website. But if in your region there's a sense that as a collective you would all really like to be reporting against the NRM plan, which I know most regions would love to be doing, And if we can add into the project location database, the project site database, category of NRM plan outcome, which of the NRM plan targets does this particular project site deliver on? If you can be having conversations with your stakeholders and partners about this being a great system for reporting against the NRM plan, then this is absolutely possible. But what has to happen before is the conversation and the agreement with the people collecting the data. So it technically, it is absolutely possible to make that happen, but it's around having the conversation with the different people involved and people agreeing to share some level of data, maybe not the detailed level, but at least the location and the summary data. Absolutely, Liz. And if they're happy to share it, they could easily send to you the same files that they send to Lee, so that you have that summary information available for your region automatically. Does that make sense, Liz?
Yeah, it does. So how would we, and you might have covered this, so how would we now know who else in our region is using Swift System to be able to ask them? Or is it an inquiry that we put to you guys and go, hey, who else is using it? Can you let them know we'd like to talk to them?
Chris and Lee, this is an interesting question. Right now, the ones that are using it that are not you, NRM bodies, are the ones that have received NRRP funding. So you know who they are in your region. They're the only ones at this point beyond our own NRM regional body sector that will be having access to the SWIFT. As if it grows in popularity as a broader tool, we would probably need, Lee, some system of being transparent about who is using the system to make that information available for better collaboration without necessarily sharing their data. But it's a conversation that we still have to have, Chris.
I'll need to keep a record of who's got what apps, so when there's an update, they can be moved, you know, copied across. So at least I'll have a record of who's got that part of it. I think we need to talk further about that.
Yeah, so from my perspective, Liz, that's a good problem to have if we get that stage. As Penny said, the only people at this stage that are theoretically licensed to use SWIFT are those five additional non-NRM regions that have got funding under NRIP. Under the IP agreement, they need to advise us if anyone else is using it beyond that, because we have done some work around the IP to do with SWIFT for obvious reasons. So we theoretically would know if anyone else is using it, because they have to actually seek permission. We don't have any issue with providing that permission, but we want to know who it is. So yeah, it's we've started that conversation with the department a little bit earlier this week. It's
having technical access to the SWIFT tools, which is where the power in the system is, access to the Survey123 apps and access to the Python script, which is kind of the clever stuff. That can't happen without Lee knowing, because he provides it individually to organisations. And as he said, for broader LCAT use, Rob Hassett knows everybody that is registered on LCAT because he provides it outside of our NRM sector. He provides access to that app. So it can be known for sure. But in terms of the relationship you have with those parties and who's prepared to, share their information, that's.
Thanks. I still think, maybe it's an area for that further development investigation, as you said, Chris. Just, you know, ideally, we've all spent a lot of time and energy in developing and reviewing our NRM plans, and ideally, we'd like everybody in our region to be reporting in a consistent way so we can understand who's doing what. But if we, I know you've got visibility on that, but if people are using SWIFT, but it's a much bigger conversation than just SWIFT. It just made me start thinking, hang on, this was only NRMs, now it's broadened. how does that work in this sense? But there's a much, much bigger conversation in that space. But if we are to still sort of maintain that our NRM plan is the heart of what we do, we want to advocate with our, you know, everybody in our community to undertake actions to support meeting those targets, which are only like 10 years away for us, then, you know, how do we get people to report? It's just, this might be a mechanism, not the only one, but it just could be. I'll park it there, but thanks.
Thank you, Liz. Okay. An important point. Lee.
Yeah, on the screen, that's the template that Penny mentioned, and that's the output that we can, that create is created straight out of Survey 123. So it will give you a report on photos and whatever really you want customized, the actual results. No free advertising, Penny, at all?
No, at all.
No.
There are my toes.
Yeah, so that's the point. The beauty about Survey 123 is it's quite simple to produce a report of whatever you've done, and you could give a copy of that back to the landholders if you wish. So okay. So that's basically Survey 123, the apps, the Python script is what we apply, or the GIS person runs to the data, and then it summarizes it and produces some output. Those outputs are then useful. I didn't mean to do that. Those outputs are quite useful to produce and roll up to a statewide perspective. And to at the moment, they go into this dashboard that's run by an Esri products. As Penny mentioned, we're looking at Power BI as a probably more stable environment, I think. So we've got our tabs, which are, this is basically an overview. We can, the person can zoom into the area they're looking at. You can search on either the electorate or local authority. Grazing land condition has the outputs of land condition, how much is being, I suppose, monitored directly with LCAT data or other information such as the grazing practices, the improved grazing practices data. So we have built a number of these to try and satisfy questions, and the more we go along, the more questions we get. So the more changes, I suppose, we're making. Power BI seems to be able to give quite a lot of flexibility. So regions are looking at that at the moment as an alternative, a feasible alternative. So that's probably in a nutshell. The apps there, I glossed over the Python scripts, and I think I probably will, because it's an area that is just something we do, I suppose. Penny.
Any other questions on the tools and the spatial aspects, the data collection analysis components of the statewide indicator framework? Or any other? So Tony's suggesting, Liz, that NRM regional bodies could put a rationale to the community about why they should provide you with the data and what value they'll get out of it. Any other questions at all at this point before we do a bit of a wrap up in terms of where to from here? Wow, that's really good. I'm not sure if that means that everybody's completely bamboozled or asleep, or that there really are no other questions, but that's this is only SWIFT 101 in many ways. So one of the things that we, you would have received a one pager from NRM Regions Queensland about the type of support we were in a position to provide project proponents, both NRM regional bodies and others, through the NRRP. And that includes visits to what we're calling the regions. So we're one of the things that's been really valuable for us and I think regional organisations over the past has been Lee and I coming and sitting down and nutting out some of those tricky little questions that you can't really ask on a webinar, looking at your current projects, talking about how they fit within the framework, discussions and questions around the mapping and the coding, questions around the which apps to use and what's not working, what is working. Those visits have been really valuable, I think, and we've been sort of doing a series of them since we began this process. Lee and I are proposing that we run the next round of visits to project proponents around February, early March next year. We're kicking off with reef catchments in early February. What we're proposing is that we will go to an NRM centre, like we will go to Longreach, or we will go to Mount Isa, we'll go to Rockhampton, Mackay, and any non-NRM regional organisation who has a project with NRRP is absolutely welcome to participate in some general discussions during that visit. And also we're very happy to do some follow-up one-on-one discussions with you as an organisation that is receiving NRRP funding and will be using the SWIF. So, that would be the next step of support that we can provide. We are also offering some training in the use of VegCat because that's the tool that's been developed under the SWIF. We don't offer training in WetCat. That would be the Queensland Wetlands Program. Contact them. And we don't offer training in LCAT. That would be DAF. So, contact Rob Hassett on that. I know that he's very keen to make sure that people are using these tools correctly and that the data that we're gathering is reasonable quality because, as I think Lee or someone else said earlier, crap data in, crap results out. We would really like people to be very conscious of the quality of the data that we're collecting and putting forward as our evidence for the impact the investment's making. Otherwise, we're all very exposed to being shot down. So, any other points, Lee, on the follow-up support, apart from the fact that Lee and I are available if you've got some very specific questions on your project, how it might fit within the framework, what if it doesn't, what do we do then, what if you can't see any home in the framework for your project whatsoever. We've developed it in such a way that it's flexible. Having said that, it definitely needs to be responding to the logic that was put forward, the SWIF logic that was put forward for NRRP. So all of those outcomes will be within the SWIF framework very soon.
Penny, with the training with LCAT, Rob's time's pretty scarce. So, but he's willing to do training. And if anybody's needing it, I'd like to try and coordinate it in regions. So there's always refreshers needed. So I'd like to get as many people as possible. So if anyone in particular wants training in LCAT, let me know. And we'll try and get Rob out there as soon as we can.
Perfect. And on that note, there's a lot of resources already available, particularly for LCAT. There are manuals and modules. There are videos, I believe. So there's already a lot of resources, and I would be making the most of those before you ask someone to come out and give you training. I will be preparing a VegCat audio visual VegCat 101 training product. So we would really like people to self-service as much as they can. And all the current resources that are available are on the NRM Regions Queensland website under the Statewide Indicators Framework page. This is also where the link to this video will be made available for people who want to pass it on to any of their team members that weren't able to make it today. So on that
on that note, I'd just like to quickly ask Kate or Deb or anybody else from the department, do you ever have anything that you would like to add from your perspective?
No, thanks, Penny. That was a really good overview.
Yeah, really was. Nothing to add. I think you've covered everything. Thanks, Penny. That was really good.
Fantastic. And perhaps, Chris, have you got any closing comments or notes or points or...
No, again, like the other said, great summary. Thanks, guys. A lot to get through. So the offer is there to make contact with Penny and Lee if you've got individual concerns or issues or opportunities. So thank you for attending today. Thanks, Penny and Lee.
Yeah, thank you very much. And as I said, this video will be uploaded to at some stage to the NRM Regions Queensland YouTube site, I think. Yep. So. Super good. All right. Well, thank you so much, everybody. Really, really appreciate you taking your time out to be with us today, and look forward to seeing you early in the new year, face to face, and hearing about your fantastic project. So happy Christmas. Merry Christmas. Have a great break between now and then.
Goodbye, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks, Penny.
Bye.
Thanks, Penny. Merry Christmas.
Yeah, thanks, Hannah. See you, everyone.